Good morning, everyone. So we had two sessions before that. In the first session, Shevan explained how we can manage enterprise IT with WSO2 products. Then in the second session, Sumedha mentioned how we can manage applications with WSO2 products. So this session is about managing business operations. So for this, we have introduced a new product called WSO2 Process Center. So we will see how we can use this product to manage business operations. Okay. So before thinking about business operations, let's consider how a typical business operates in today's environment. So in today's business, it's a connection of many organizations, so many entities. So for example, if we take something like this, so this is a typical business, so it has can have many shopping outlets and many offices, factories, partners, and logistics companies, and so on. So this is the how a business looks like. So if we take a simple business operation, like for example, selling an item, it may also involve many of these entities. For example, when a customer sends a request to purchase some item, for example, so he goes to a shopping outlet and orders an item. Then it has to go to an office, and this office may coordinate with multiple factories to produce this item. And these factories may have to order some parts from other partners. And once the product is built, it has to be shipped back to the shopping outlet so that customer can collect it. So likewise, any simple business operation can also involve many business entities. So if we take a closer look about this, at that more detailed level also, we have many smaller items connected for a simple business operation. So we are again considering the same business operation of selling an item. So for this, we have multiple entities, like shipping systems, IT systems can be involved, like shipping system, HR system, inventory systems, and so on. And multiple users can also be involved, like employees, customers, and so on. Then another important thing is that there are documents, so data objects are also involved. Like, for example, when you are initiating a sales process, we have to first fill out an order form and submit it. Then we may have supply agreements with different suppliers, and we may also have a form to fill in shipping details. So we have to connect all these multiple entities to do a simple business operation. So that is not an easy thing. So what is the solution? Solution is to wire up all these things in a business process. So this is where business process management comes in. So here again, we have all those items that we have that I have mentioned earlier, but I have wired these items into a set of tasks in a flow, which we can call as a workflow. So once we do this wiring up, we can associate each of these items into one of these tasks. And also this business, so we call this a business process. So now there are multiple things to consider here. First is that this business process has a flow. For example, we can see that this task is followed by this task. So that is a sequence. And also, if we take these two tasks, we are saying that either of these tasks can followed by this, depending on the input that we have given in these tasks. Then we have associated multiple resources. Like, for example, we say that this task is performed by this employee, and this customer has to initiate the process, and so on. Then also, we have to specify the IT systems and other documents required for this process. So this is the basics of business process management, that is to come up with a business process. But that is not all. If we want to do a proper business process management project, we have to consider multiple stages, which forms a life cycle. So the first part is the thing that we have discussed, that is process design. That means to identify your processes and details of those processes. So each of these stages gives you some benefits as well. So once we do the process design, what we come up with is a collection of process documentations. So by just using these documentations, we can gain more insight into our business operations. Then based on this, we can construct some basic level of process models. And using those models, we can do some process analysis. Like for example, if we associate details about costs for each task, we can compute the cost of performing that process. Or if we associate all resource requirements, we can do resource analysis based on that. So if you want to do more advanced analysis, we can run simulation models and so on. So the benefit of this is that we can analyze how an organization would perform without actually implementing these processes. And based on those outcomes, we can do some level of improvements to the processes as well. So once we improve these processes, we can implement this. So when it comes to implementation, there are two ways. One is that we can simply run those processes manually. That means we are not using any information system, but we are just making those process documentations available for employees so that they can just go through them and follow it. Then the other level of implementation is process automation. That means we create executable process models out of our process documentations and deploy them in process servers so that process can be run automatically. Then whatever the method we use for implementation, we can collect events from those running processes. So based on those events, we can do process monitoring. That means we can analyze how, there are two ways. One is that we can analyze how current process instance is performing, and we can also analyze how historical process instances have performed. Then based on that analysis, we can do process optimizations. For example, we can identify which resources has to be allocated if you want to run this process better. Then based on this process optimization stage, we can come up with optimization proposals, which comes back to the process design, where we improve our existing models based on this. So this is the complete BPM life cycle. So if some organization want to get the complete benefit from BPM, they have to undergo all these stages. But most organizations are a bit reluctant to do comprehensive BPM projects. So let's see why. So first thing is that there are large amount of processes in any given organization. So there can be processes for obvious ones like purchasing items, selling a product, and so on. But there are many other small processes as well. For example, for scheduling an interview, there is a process. For selecting suppliers or evaluating employees, for all these things, there are processes. So if we want to do BPM effectively, we have to understand at least most of these processes. So identifying all these processes is not an easy task. So that is one barrier. Then the other part is that in any given process, there are large amount of details involved. For example, if we take a process like this, first we have to identify these steps in the process. So each of these steps can be further divided into another set of steps. Like that, there can be a large number of steps for a process. Then for each of these steps, we have to identify stakeholders and resources involved. Then, again, we have to identify the relationships among these steps as well. So if we once we start really doing this, we figure out that identifying all these details is not an easy task. But the point is that if we want to gain more control about our processes, we have to capture more details. Then the third part is that, as I mentioned earlier, process analytics is a key part of BPM. But there's a problem again. That means, as I mentioned earlier, there can be hundreds of processes in an organization. And each of these processes can be run, let's say, hundreds of or thousands of times within a day. So if we collect events emitted from these processes for a certain amount of time, for example, for 3 months, we may collect huge amount of events. So we have to employ certain big data analytics techniques in order to analyze such large amounts of data. So analyzing and capturing these events is also not an easy task. So what is the answer? So if you want to simplify BPM, one thing is that we have to have a central location to manage all our processes so that people who are creating processes can simply create processes in whatever the notation or way they are comfortable with and just put those processes in this collection. Then because there are a large number of processes and there are many details involved in a process, it is not possible to create a process in a single step. So there have to, it is usually we have to undergo multiple iterations. So we have to facilitate collaboration among users. That means once a process is created, other users should be able to access it and review it and give suggestions for improvement and also edit this and should be able to do all these things. Then when it comes to implementation, process developers or technical people should be able to get processes from this collection and create executable processes out of them and also associate these executable processes with this central location itself. So this is one part of simplifying BPM. Then the other side of the story is about process participants. Those are normal users who use processes in day-to-day life. So these people should be able to easily search and discover processes that they want to execute. So this can be based on simple text search, or there can be other advanced search mechanisms involved. So once they discover the process, if they want to execute this process manually, they can simply go through the documentation and follow the steps mentioned there. But if the process is automated, this central location for processes should allow them to start a process instance within itself. So they don't have to go to any other place to execute a process. They can simply search the process and start an instance and get the work done. So therefore, we have to integrate all other required systems with this central location itself. Okay. So then when it comes to analytics, what we need to do is that we have multiple systems that are executing processes. So we have to integrate these systems with our central process collection. So these systems can emit events to this collection. Then we have the models and the events, so we can easily generate dashboards about running processes and present them to relevant users. So this is the abstract idea we need to implement in order to simplify BPM. So let's see how Process Center does it. So this is an overview of Process Center, basically positioning of it. So we have Process Center here, and it is integrated with multiple editors. So there can be text editors, flowchart editors, BPMN editors, Google Docs, and anything. So any person can use one of these tools to create processes using whatever the method they are comfortable with, and just create processes and store them in the Process Center. Then we have integrated process runtimes with the Process Center so that if someone decided to create an executable model out of one of these processes, they can simply upload the executable model so that it will be associated with one of these process runtimes. Then in order to perform data analytics, we have integrated WSO2 data analytics server, which is capable of doing batch processing as well as real-time processing. Then we have integrated dashboards with the Process Center so that users can specify various analytics methods and generate dashboards about running processes. So this is an overview about the Process Center. Now let's see how this Process Center fits into the BPM lifecycle I have mentioned earlier. So we have the process design part is covered by multiple editors and creation and searching facilities provided by the Process Center. Then process analysis is also covered by Process Center because we are planning to offer various analytics features like simulations, cost-based analysis, and so on. Then process implementation is done mainly by the business process server of WSO2, which is capable of executing BPMN and BPL models. Also, if you want to integrate business rules, we can have WSO2 business rules serve as well. Then monitoring is done by the combination of WSO2 data analytics server and process server, as I mentioned earlier. Then for process optimization, we have to combine all those products, that is a PC, BPS, and DAS, so that once we do the analytics, we can come up with optimization proposals, and PC can guide users to select one of those proposals, and these proposals can be implemented in BPS. So this is how BPM lifecycle is supported by WSO2 products. Now let's consider one usage of process center, that is to create a process. So we have a process owner or a business analyst who use multiple editors available in process center to create processes and store there. Then we have process participants who can search and discover processes and execute them either manually or using executable models. Then we have process developers who can access process models stored in the process center and make executable models out of them and put those in associated process servers. So this is one usage. So let's go through a few of the screenshots for supporting this use case. So this is a screenshot for creating a process. So we can first give simple details about the process, like process name, version, owner, tags, and so on, and create a process. Also, we can describe the process in multiple ways. Currently, we only support textual descriptions and BPMN models, but soon we will support other methods like flowcharts and so on. Then we can specify associations among processes. For example, here we are specifying that this process is a subprocess of the process that we are creating. So this is a screenshot of describing the process in text. And this is how we can associate a BPMN model with a process. So once we create the process, we can undergo a life cycle for publishing the process. And each of these life cycle phases, we can give previews for them as well before promoting. Then once we promote it, we can publish it so that the process participants can access it. So this is the view for process participants. Those are the normal users of the process. So they will get a list of all processes that are authorized for them, so that they can click on those and go to the details. So they can browse the textual description, and they can view the BPMN model and so on. So that is the simple part of that. That means creating and browsing processes. But we can support multiple advanced things as well. For example, we can support, we also already support tag and metadata-based search. And we can support process text search. And also, we can support graph-based search. That means if we define the process as a BPMN model, we can give graph-based queries. For example, you can give that, find me all items where ship items task is preceded by package items task. Then the process center can go to the process repository and find all process models that match this graph fragment. Then we can also do process standardization. That means once we have a large collection of models, we can ask process center to find all models that have similar sections, so that we can replace those sections with a common standard fragment. Another thing, similar thing, is the process reuse. That means once we model a new process, we can ask process center to find out all fragments that are dealing with certain functionality. For example, without modeling the shipment handling fragment from the scratch, we can ask process center to find all fragments that are dealing with shipment handling and just include them in the process. So that's one side of the story. The other side is about analytics. That means, so this is the flow of that. So users go to the process center and discover processes and execute them. So the execution is done in business process server. So this process server sends events to the data analytics server, which runs analytics scripts and generate dashboards in process center, which can be browsed by business analysts, for example. Now let's go through some examples in process center. So here we are going to analyze what are the processes that are taking most time to complete. So we have gone to a dashboard which displays average execution times of processes. So from this dashboard, we see that this process which is called a manual task process, is taking more time. So we want to further analyze this process. So what we do is that we go into more details of this selected process. So we have selected the process here. And we are analyzing the average time taken by different tasks of this process. So by this view, we know that this task, which is called place order task, is taking most of the time. So we want to analyze this task further. So we drill down into that. So we select that task there, and we go to a visualization where we display average time taken by different users to complete this task. So from this view, we identify that admin user is taking more time to complete this task. So we may decide that we don't want him to perform this task. So likewise, we can get many other analytics dashboards as well. So I'm not going into details of each of these. Now, another interesting thing that we can do is to specify thresholds. So in similar analytics dashboards that we saw earlier, we can specify thresholds, for example, saying that average sales of each branch should not be below $2,000 per month. So once you specify a threshold like this, the process center can trigger an event or an action if this threshold is violated. Then another interesting thing is predictions. That means once we store all our processes in the process center, we have a collection of models. And once we integrate all event sources with the process center, we know all historical data about our processes. Then we have our models, we have our historical data, and once we run a certain process instance, we have the current state of our process. So we can combine all these things and apply certain prediction algorithms like classification trees and come up with predictions about what can happen in future about this process. So this is an example. Here we are running a process, so we have our data about the current instance here, and we know from the historical data about the future tasks here. Now, by combining this data, we can predict the estimated remaining time for this process. Then another part is about recommendations, which is also similar to predictions, but here we have established a goal. That means we are saying that we want to complete this process within 4 days. So what should we do? So again, process center can analyze historical data and give certain recommendations for achieving this goal. For example, here it is saying that if you want to complete this within 4 days, you have to select these two as suppliers. And you have to select these K-lines as the shipper. So we can do things like this by combining current models, current data about processes, and historical data about processes. Okay. So then we come to another interesting area where we combine processes and Internet of Things. Now, if we take a normal process, if we want to do effective analytics, we want to capture more data about the process. So if we take a task where a human is involved, it is easy to capture data about that, because human will log into a computer and enters data, so that we can just push those data into the analytics server. But there are certain tasks where there is no human involvement. For example, if we take this process fragment, we have a task for loading package, transporting the package to the port, and shipping package. So there are no direct human input for this task. So it is very hard to capture events. But if we use IoT-enabled devices, we can, for example, let forklift to send events about this task to the process center. So whenever it picks up a package, it will send these details to the process center. Then whenever the truck transports a package, it sends these details to the process center. Then we can correlate these events with the process models that we already have in the process center and come up with very comprehensive analytics about processes. Then there's another interesting thing, that is, let's say that we are getting events from these IoT devices and correlating them to a process model, but we are getting some events from an event stream which we cannot correlate to any task in the process model. So this can be a case where we are missing some task in the process model, but in the real world, this task is performed. So in this case, we can employ certain process discovery algorithms and construct new process models based on these event streams. So that is another interesting area that we can consider in process center. So this is how the process center can help in achieving a real business process management projects. So we have discussed things like how we can simplify creation of processes, how we can simplify exploring and executing processes, and how we can simplify analytics using WSO2 Process Center. So that is all about managing business operations. So thank you.